Can we put our hands together one more time for the praise and worship team this morning? You know, I love the part of the song where he says, I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. Anybody believe God can still move mountains? Anybody still believe that God is still a miracle worker, a problem solver? I know the band is still playing. I see you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I'll see you do it again. I see you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. Oh, yeah. Come on, put your hands together if you believe God will do it again. You know, I'm just so excited to be back in the house of the Lord. It was a week ago I couldn't stand up here, but I thank God for his healing power. I thank God to be back with all of you this morning. I thank God to be back because the Bible says where two or three are gathered together in his name, he's here. And if he's here, he wants to do something special this morning. And so I just want to prepare you for the second part of this amazing sermon series that we're in, The Great Divide. Let God minister to your heart this morning.
All right. Come on, somebody, give the Lord Jesus a hand clap of praise in this place. It is so good to be here. So excited to share God's word with you today. You know, I always like to say you're not here by accident, incident, or circumstance. You're here today because your steps have been ordered by the Lord. And, I'm going to say that enough that it's going to drop in somebody's spirit, and you're going to believe it, and you're going to run with it, and you'll never live life the way that you're going to live it. When you have the confidence to know when you get up in the morning that you have a God that's already been working, even through the midnight hour, you serve a God that is yet working. Even when you don't see him, he is yet working. Even when you don't feel him, he is yet working. I'm just excited enough about it to share the good news with you that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And it's that revelation that is yet continually changing my life, and I believe it'll change yours. It's been so good to worship with you this morning. How many of you enjoyed worship this morning? Amen. I tell you, there's something powerful that can happen in worship. When we move past singing songs just from our lips, and we start singing songs from the bottom of our heart, you will connect with God in such a powerful way. It will wreck you. It will transform you. It will change you. And I don't know about you, but sometimes we can just get complacent in our worship. We can get complacent in our praise. It could become formality. It could become ritualistic. It could become a line item on the program. But when it comes from the bottom of your heart, you connect with heaven. And the Holy Spirit will do a work in your life. I want to encourage you to worship the Lord with your whole heart. And never underestimate the power of your praise. Never underestimate the power of your praise. And never take for granted the opportunity to give him praise and glory and honor. Because you never know where your praise from your heart can cause heaven to release a secret that will change your life forever. It's in the secret place. It's not in the outer court. So much we spend time praising in the outer court. We spend time worshiping in the outer court with all the distractions. I want to help somebody this morning before we get into our sermon. In the inner court, knocking on heaven's door, you may hear something that you would not have heard. And it's not because God doesn't want to tell us things. It's because we're so busy, so distracted, so indifferent, so laissez-faire, so it is what it is. But I'm here to tell you, if you would chase after God, he could speak something to you that'll change everything. And I want to encourage you that way today. Don't take praise and worship for granted. It is not a concert. It is not just a good thing to do. And it's not something that you only do when you come to a church gathering. In your personal time, connect with him. I connected with God this week back in that little room all by myself. And when I got through being in God's presence with tissue and snotting and crying, you would have thought a whole praise and worship team was back there with me. You would have thought somebody preached the best sermon ever to me. And God whispered things that changed me. As a result of spending some real time in his presence this week, I can tell you I am not the same. I'm not the same person you saw last week. I know I look the same, but something changed, and he spoke some things to me. And I want to encourage each of you to press into his presence. Get closer to God. Open up your heart. Don't be afraid to open up your heart. Don't be afraid to just let go and let God. You don't know what he is going to do and what he's going to say. You will never be the same again. Somebody give him a hand clap of praise. So we're in this series, The Great Divide. This is part two of a three-part series. And on last week, we talked about the power of unity. How the scripture says a house divided against itself cannot stand. And yet, the church is called to be an assembly, a gathering, a coming together of a community of believers, a community of Jesus followers, for the express purpose of following the teachings of Jesus Christ. And there's something powerful that happens when the church continues to gather and stay on mission to fulfill the Great Commission and the Great Commandment. Something happens. The church becomes dangerous, and the church becomes a threat to the kingdom of darkness. And when we are the ecclesia, the called out, the legal assembly that does business for heaven in the earth realm, things can change. And the church, the believers, the called out, are the salt and the light of the earth. The salt has a preserving agent to it. It preserves things. And the church is preserving things until Jesus Christ comes back again. Because once the church is removed, literally, not figuratively, when the church is removed, literally, all hell is going to break loose. The only thing preserving things right now is the church, the ecclesia, the assembly, the gathering. And God is long-suffering and patient, and would that none perish, but that all would come to a place of repentance. So as a church, we're preserving things until he comes. Our job, our mandate, is to share the good news so that people can come into God's family. We are the light of the world. We're literally the hope. In darkness, we're the light. You heard people use the terminology, oh, there's light. I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Light is hope. When they're saying, I can see the light at the end of the tunnel, they're saying, I got hope now, right? The church is the hope of the world. So it's so important in this season. This may be one of the most important messages that I've ever shared, this sermon series. Probably in this particular generation, that the church, the bride of Christ, has to do everything that we can do to not be divided, to stay united. And in the complexities that we're living in our society today, in the midst of a global pandemic and so much other things going on in our society, politically, ethnically, economically, you name it, there's a lot of tension in our society today that's pulling us, tempting to pulling us apart at the seam. And yet it's the church that Jesus says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So whenever the church is overcoming, it's the church that Jesus is building. The church that's not just hearers only, but also doers of the word. Right? And yet, there's a tension in our society that's pulling us apart to divide us. The church is the hope of the world. So goes the church, so goes the world. So I'm like the Apostle Paul today. I'm not speaking to the world. I'm speaking to the church. Because if the church is the church, it'll affect the world. No need for us to preach to the world. We got one message to the world. Jesus is Lord. Jesus died for our sins. But if we, the church, lose our saltiness, if our light goes out, we got a problem. And Satan knows that. He's been a divider from the beginning. The Bible says when men don't obey the things of God, it's because Satan's spirit is working in their heart. He's been a divider from the beginning. It was Satan that led mutiny in heaven, who took a third of the angels and convinced them to war against God. It was Satan that was cast out of heaven for leading mutiny. But it's the same Satan, the same devil, Diabolos, the divider, who we saw in the Garden of Eden. When God had given Adam the command to not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and given that to Adam, Adam gives it the instructions to his wife Eve. Eve, we're not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And who shows up in the garden but the divider? Now he's about to divide the very first family. They were to be united around the commandment that God had given them. And here comes Satan to divide the house. And he tempts Eve to do something to bring her out of unity with her husband, Adam. He's the great divider. He's the accuser of the brethren. And then not only that, because of his tempting of Eve, and she eats from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and it puts a divide in her household for Adam not to be separated from Eve. Adam chooses to eat the same fruit that Eve eats, and now they're both separated from God. He's a divider. He's an accuser. He's a liar. And the father of lies. And here we are as a church. The Bible says we're not ignorant of his devices, of his schemes, of his ways, of his maneuvering. And so, with all that's going on in our society today, the great divide that is in our society, facing the issues that divide us as a church, we've been unpacking, and we'll unpack for the next couple of weeks. What does the Bible say about the church being united and getting past tearing down the walls and building bridges so that we're not divided, so that we can be the hope of the world, so that we can be the salt of the earth? And so last week, and our foundational scripture for these next couple of weeks is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. It says this: I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions. Somebody say, no divisions. In the church, not in society, not in the world. He's speaking to the church, to the believers. Let there be no divisions in the ecclesia, the ecclesia. And then he doesn't stop there. He says, rather be of one mind. Instead of being divided, be one mind, united in thought and purpose. Remember, we talked about that word harmony. We know what it means to harmonize in singing and music. The word there is where we get the word symphony, right? To be in harmony, in agreement with. It's beautiful. And it has this connotation of laying an argument to rest. Anything that would cause it to not be harmonious. Any issues that would cause the church not to be harmonious, lay those arguments down. So that, somebody say, so that we can be united, so that there be no divisions, schizo, like schizophrenia, a person has a separate personality, they're divided, that there be no schisms is the word, there be nothing that separates us from one another, let there be no schisms in the church. There'll be nothing that would cause an internal divide. Not your denominational beliefs, not your personal beliefs. Like, let there be no inward schism. It was a horrible thing to be called a schismatic, which is a person who causes division in the church. And there's places in Scripture that says that person is the worst person to have in the church and put them out. Because like a rotten apple. It'll tear the thing apart. So he said, don't have any separation, don't have any gap, don't have a divide in the church. Rather, so it's not just enough to try not to do something, but then what should we be doing? We should be united in thought and purpose. That is something that the church has to continually work toward. It's not automatic. Like, we don't drift into unity. Unity is intentional, and we have to unite around a purpose. I mean, if anybody watched a documentary on Michael Jordan, you know that there was a lot of schism on that team, on that Bulls, that six-time world championship basketball team had some schisms, but they decided that they would play in harmony. Whatever was going on off the court, whatever was pulling them, whatever issues they had going on, they made a decision that when they touched that hardwood, that they were going to lay aside whatever was dividing them. And, well, I ain't passing you the ball because I'm still mad about what you did last night. No, I'm going to get on this court. I'm going to lay aside whatever was going on so that we can be in harmony. We're going to unite around a purpose to win a championship. What a powerful illustration of what a sports team is willing to do for a championship. The church has a purpose. We have to unite around our purpose and lay aside arguments so we can be in harmony to fulfill the purpose. Jesus makes the purpose clear. Before he left earth, before he ascended back to the Father, he said, team, come on in. Right? After he resurrected, he met with them in Acts chapter 1. He told them what the mission was. What's the end game? What's the goal? The goal is to take the gospel of love of Jesus dying for the world's sin to a world who didn't know him. That's what the church is supposed to be united around. That is the unifying agent. That is the church at its core. We can differ on how you think we should be baptized. We can differ on how you think we should take communion and when you think we should take communion. We can differ on who you think should preach and who can't preach. But we cannot differ on the fact that we are to take the gospel of Jesus Christ to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Hello, somebody. Somebody said united. United in thought and purpose. There was in the church 2,000 years ago a tension, a schism based on ethnicity. There was ethnicism going on in the church. Ethnicism is akin to racism. The difference being, racism suggests that there are different races, like different species of people. We know that's not true, but we still use the word racism today. There's probably a minority of people who still think that, oh, we are different species. We all have different origins. But most of us have come to believe and know what the Bible's already told us, that we are one people. We are one race. So the Bible doesn't address racism because the Bible teaches that there's one blood. The Bible teaches that all men came from Adam and Eve. After the flood, Noah and his family, right? So a more correct term, I could have used racism, but I want to be more correct. I want you to know that racism is not in the Bible because racism is a made-up idea by man. But ethnicism was real in the Bible. And that was being prejudiced and discriminatory against a group of people, another ethnic group. No less damaging to the body of Christ for me to use ethnicism versus racism. I just want to make sure we understand a little more clearly of what we're talking about, a little more correctly. But it was evil, and it was sinful, and it was against God. And I could have set the story up, and you would have thought I was talking about the church today. There was ethnicism, there was prejudice and discrimination going on in the church a few years after Jesus is gone. Because it was there before he left. And so the Apostle Paul, who's now trying to lead and guide the church in Ephesus, has to address this community of believers because they're having schisms, divisions in the church because of their ethnicity. And God doesn't want us to allow our ethnicity to get in the way of our unity. And if we're not careful, our ethnicity will get in the way of our unity and keep us divided. But we want to bridge the divide. So we're going to take a look at a letter that Paul wrote to the church of Ephesus, a burgeoning church, a growing church, a church that had Jewish believers and Gentile believers. And these Jewish believers and these Gentile believers are trying to figure out how they're going to get along and stay united in purpose to do the will of God. So we find here in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. Don't forget, this is Paul writing, don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders. Somebody say outsiders. You were called uncircumcised heathens by the Jews. Well, that's some nice language. Heathen just sound bad, doesn't it? It's got something on it. You're just a heathen. Anybody want to be a heathen? Even if you don't know what it means, you don't want to be it, right? Uncircumcised heathens by the Jews. Who were proud of their circumcision. Somebody say proud. They were proud of their circumcision. Even though, watch this, it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. They were proud of their ethnicity. When they talk about their circumcision, they're saying that's what sets them apart from every other people group. When it says, don't forget that you were Gentiles, that word Gentiles is ethne. Ethne is where we get the word ethnic. So he's saying, even though you were a different ethnicity, you were not the same ethnicity as the Jews, and the Jews knew that they were a different ethnicity by the very fact that they had circumcision. And they were proud. He said, you were outsiders. Your ethnicity was treated as outsiders. And the Jews were proud of what made their identity. Even though thing that they were so proud about. The thing that they were so, you know, had their chest poked out about. The reason they had their head lifted so high. Paul says it didn't even affect their hearts. And so what happens is when we get into a place where we allow our ethnic differences to cause us to treat others as outsiders, and we start to feel proud about our ethnicity in such a way that it causes us to discriminate or treat other people differently, it creates this. It creates a us versus them kind of mentality. They're the outsiders. We're the insiders. And our society is like that. I sit on the red side of the aisle, and those outsiders sit on the blue side of the aisle. I sit with the black kids. I sit with the white kids at lunch. I'm a Buckeye. They're a Wolverine. It creates a us versus them mentality. And that's what was going on in the church. The Jews felt proud about what made them different. Some of us today, if we're honest, we got a sense of pride, puffed upness about the thing that makes us different. And it could be anything can create an us versus them. A political party can create an us versus them. A skin color can create an us versus them. The side of town you live on can create an us versus them. And these become walls. What's the thing that you've become proud of that's actually become a wall? What's the thing that you're proud of that's keeping you separated from your brother and your sister? Because if we're not careful, for the Jews, it was their circumcision. It made them feel better than. Even though Paul said, your circumcision didn't do anything for you to get closer to God. Your heart is messed up. And so the thing that must happen, the thing that has happened, that we must realize that has happened, is that the thing that tears down the walls of division is love. It is love that tears down whatever walls that erect themselves to separate us from one another. There's so many walls, and they don't make any sense sometimes. I remember being a kid. I grew up in the inner city of Toledo, on Lawrence, started on Linwood, urban renewal came, ended up on Lawrence, and then something happened, the crack epidemic happened, and a movie called Colors, some of y'all know that movie, came out, and when that movie came out, in the middle of a crack epidemic, like the next day, like the weekend it came out, I remember like Saturday, like all of a sudden everybody was wearing bandanas, red and blue, all over Toledo, like just like that. And all of a sudden, kids that we grew up with, some of y'all know what I'm talking about, like we played together, like we rode our bikes across town, like all of a sudden in a weekend, like that changed. All of a sudden, we couldn't play with each other. We couldn't like each other. Because now it was a Crips and the Bloods. And it didn't make any sense, and it became this wall of division. I remember thinking like, man, I had no idea when I became an adult that politics could be no different than gangs. I'm like, are y'all kidding me? Like, I grew up watching this red and blue thing. And this looks no different to me. I'm just being real. I'm like, wow, what happened? The only thing that tears down walls of division is love. Jesus says this in John. He says this, John chapter 15, verse 13. He says, there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. Jesus says that true agapeistic love is sacrificial. Agape love sacrifices self-interest in the interest of somebody else. Somebody say agape. This is what Paul is going to begin to share in his letter to the church of Ephesus, a church that is a multi-ethnic church. Somebody say multi-ethnic church. Now, it would have been easy if Paul was leading a mono-ethnic church. Oh, if he was just leading a Jewish church, he could have preached circumcision all day long if he wanted to. If he was leading a Gentile church, it would have been a whole different story. But God never meant to have a mono-ethnic church. When you read in the book of Revelation and it said that every nationality, every tongue and kindred, that word nationality is again the word ethne, ethnos, ethnic. Every ethnicity under heaven was represented in the book of Revelation of those going in to be with the Lord. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. If your message, if your belief system is not one that can be embraced by a multi-ethnic body, it is not the right message. Hello, somebody. But we like our comfortability. God doesn't like you and your comfortability. It is devil, Diablo, who is the divider. God is the unifier. And he's like, no, you would have thought it would have been easy for Paul to say, I know what we're going to do since there's so much ethnic tension. Here's what we're going to do. Here's the easy thing to do. Jews, you worship at this time. Gentiles, you worship at that time. Stay away from each other and worship God. See, that would have been the easy answer. Where we as people have nothing to do. We just love God. We love God. And Paul says, no. Let me help you guys understand something. Ephesians chapter 2 says this, verse 14. Somebody say Christ. For Christ himself has brought peace to us. He united Jews and Gentiles, other ethnicities that were not Jewish. He united Jews and Gentiles into one people. When in his own body on the cross, he broke down the wall of hostility. On the cross, somebody say the cross. See, the cross became the bridge that was dividing the ethnicities. Hello, somebody. See, Satan got in the mix and things got separate. And Jesus came in his own body on the cross. The cross represents love. When I say love tears down walls, what Jesus Christ did on the cross was the greatest example of love. He says, no greater love is there than for a man, hello somebody, to lay down his life for his friends. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. And the cross became the bridge to bring the separated ethnic groups together the way that God, our Father, intended it to be. Shame on us if Jesus has put the cross in the middle of the chasm and allow us to be able to walk across. Shame on us if we don't walk across the bridge that Jesus has placed there. I'm not standing on the other side. I'm going to come and I'm going to cross the bridge where my brothers and sisters are. Hello, somebody. Whenever you think division, I want from now on you to think devil. Unless you're trying to figure out how to divide your money to give me some. Yeah, someone said sharing. Sharing is caring. God isn't dividing us, people. On the cross, in his body, he broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. That word hostility is a strong word. It is where we get the word enmity. When in the Garden of Eden, and after Adam and Eve sinned, and you know, it was some division because Adam blamed it on Eve, right? You know, Adam, what's going on? What you doing eating from the fruit, and how you know you're naked and all that? And what? Well, that woman that you gave me, and then she said, well, that serpent, you should have dealt with him a long time ago, but you didn't deal with him, and so he came and tricked me. The blame game. And God says something. He said there's going to be enmity between people and Satan. And he said the seed of the woman is going to crush your head, but you're going to bruise his heel. That word enmity literally means no truce. Like there's never, if you ever think the devil is, don't ever make a deal with the devil like this. Say, devil, if you just leave my family alone, we good. I mean, let's just not mess with each other. The devil is a liar. You are a child of God. You've been given authority. You've been given the keys of the kingdom. That whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth and loose in heaven. He said, I've given you power over all the power of the enemy. So you stick your chest out, lift your head up, and know you got more power than Satan. You don't got to be making a deal with the devil. I lost my train of thought because that made me upset. Enmity means no truce. You can wave a white flag if you want to and think he'd go, okay. No. He said there was enmity between the ethnic groups. Called each other horrible names, thought horrible things. We're like that in our society. You see it all the time. When you see ethnic cleansing going on around the world, they'll call the people roaches. They'll dehumanize them. Roaches, dogs, scum. Anything, right, but a person. You start using the labels. We got to be careful. Stop using labels on people because it takes the human factor out. Oh, that's a liberal over there. Oh, that's a conservative over there. Oh, that's a Republican. Oh, that's a black man over there. Like, if you just start using too many labels, you'll start taking the human factor out, and it'll be easier for you to treat somebody like they're not a child of God. Y'all catching me? That's a Crip. That's a Blood. No, that's my friend Thomas. I remember Thomas. Man, we used to play kickball with you. Oh, Lord. That's hostility. And it literally means hatred, right? He tore down the wall of hatred and enmity that separated the ethnic groups so they can come together. Next verse, it says this, verse 16. Together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. Christ's death put our hatred for one another to death. We as children of God should no longer be harboring any type of hatred for any other ethnic group. If you're a Christian and you got hostility in your heart toward another people group, that's not God. That's the spirit of Satan working in your heart. That's not the spirit of God. Somebody say amen. I know that's tight, but it's right. Somebody say it's tight, but it's right. That's scripture. Don't come at me. I love preaching scripture because at the end of the day, if you want to send me an email, I'm just going to take you to the scripture. He says, Satan working in my heart. No, the scripture says if you disobey God, that is the spirit of Satan working in your heart. I didn't say it. He said it. Something about that, right? And so we understand this, that love that lays down tears down. The type of love that is sacrificial, that Jesus demonstrated on the cross, tears down the walls of division so that we can be united in thought and purpose. And so what I want to end with is five barriers that divide us that love tears down. So we know what Jesus did. Now it's what are we going to do? Like to daily walk this out. So that it's not just a good sermon. It's not just all on Jesus. Jesus paid it all. Yes, he did. Now we got to walk it out. So the first barrier. Love tears down the barrier of hate. Love tears down the barrier of hate. Hate separates. Hate causes a divide. It becomes a barrier. It says this in Mark 12 and 31. The second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these. If we stay on mission, our mission is love. You're going to see where love tears down all of these barriers. These are the roots of ethnicism or racism. These five things I'm giving you are the roots, the barriers of ethnicism or racism. The word hate means love less. When Jesus says, you know, if you don't hate your mother or your father, you're not worthy of me. He don't really mean like hate them. When you look that word up in the Greek, it means to love less. If you love less a different ethnic group than you love the ethnic group you identify with, that's hate. If you're like, I don't hate them. I just don't love them like I love my ethnic group. The Bible calls that hate. The great commandment is love your neighbor as yourself. You don't have the liberty to love them just a little less than yourself. I'm okay with the Europeans, but them Asians... I'm okay with the Asians, but them Africans, or them Haitians, or whatever. Like, you have to love your neighbor as yourself. And love tears down the barrier of hate, this great commandment, because it equalizes it. So I say amen. The second barrier love tears down the barrier of pride. Think we're better than those. Think we're better people, smarter people, cleaner people, whatever that is. That's pride. When you think some other group is inferior to you, that's arrogance. That's pride. But love will tear that down. Scripture says this, Philippians chapter 2, verse 2 and 3. He says, then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. Somebody say loving. Loving one another and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Somebody say be humble. Thinking of others as better than yourselves. Real love doesn't look at other people as they are inferior. Rather, real love is humble. Jesus humbled himself and washed our feet. Hello, somebody. That ain't the love of God if you think that some group of people is inferior to you. If the Jews think the Gentiles are inferior to them, if the Gentiles think the Jews are inferior to them, that's not the love of God. Be humble. Somebody say humble. Think of others as better than yourselves. That's love. The third barrier that's torn down by love is greed. When you get filled with greed, a person or an ethnic group gets filled with greed, You see a lot of genocide take place because I want all the resources. I want more. I need more. I don't have enough. I don't have enough. It's insatiable, right? Unending. Yet, Scripture says this, same Philippians, but jump into verse 4. Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Here goes verse 4. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Love doesn't just want for me and my four and no more. We're good. I don't know what y'all gonna do. I'm good. Woo, we got food. We got food for days. It don't matter to me. You don't have any. Love doesn't produce greed, but love produces generosity, the opposite of greed. Love thinks about others' interests too. Somebody say love tears down the barrier of greed. Number 4. Love tears down the barrier of fear. I'm afraid to go around that ethnic group. There's fear. And the fear becomes a barrier. And it's natural to have that fear. But the Bible challenges that fear for a greater purpose. Because if the Jews would have just stayed fearful of really interacting with other ethnic groups, they could not have fulfilled the what? The Great Commission. Now, I'm sure they felt real good about take the gospel to Jerusalem. Yay! Take the gospel to Judea. Yay! Take the gospel to Samaria. Well, it is kind of like distant cousins, I guess. And to the ends of the earth. Whoa, wait. I ain't never been around them. And I don't heard stories about them. I don't heard something about them Gentiles. I'm not going there. God didn't ask you. Isn't it interesting how God doesn't ask us? Like God didn't ask the Jews if it was okay. Like, he said, Peter, in a trance, he caused a blanket to come down and some food that Peter said was unclean. And he said, don't call unclean what I said is clean. He said, now you go to Cornelius' house. I ain't ask you. I'm about to take my spirit to them. And when you talk to them, watch the Holy Spirit going to fall on them just like he did on y'all. He didn't ask for their permission. He didn't ask for the Jews' permission about causing Paul to become a believer. Remember when he was Saul of Tarsus and was persecuting everybody? He didn't say, hey, y'all mind if I pick the guy that's been killing y'all? Are y'all okay with that? Because if y'all give me a thumbs up, I'm going to pick him. No, he like, yeah, I'm going to knock him off of his horse on his way to Damascus, and I'm going to tell him that he's going to now work for me. And they didn't get the memo because when Paul showed up, they were like, hey, ain't that the guy that was killing us? I ain't really sure if he a believer. They say he is. Like, God don't ask for our permission. Like, in the kingdom of heaven, it's not a democracy, right? So there could be this fear. I got to hurry up. I'm long this morning. I got one more point. Here's what the scripture says. Somebody say, God. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity. That word fear means cowardice. But of power, love, and a sound mind or self-discipline. This translation. Really what he's saying is this. I'm telling you to go into all the world. And if you feel timid, like, oh, I can't go around those people. I don't know. I've never been around them. He said, wait, I didn't give you that. Well, you just don't know me. I'm just, no, he's like, no. And this ain't about your personality. I know you don't did all the personality profile, but when I called you, I gave you something that had power in it. When I gave you, it didn't have cowardice in it. He said, when I gave you, it had power to cause you to be witnesses. Come on, somebody. And you shall be, not might be, but you shall be witnesses. Hello, somebody. He said, so I give you power. So don't talk about you all timid. I don't know. I ain't never been around them. I don't know. He said, and love.
Because love is so powerful. Here's the idea that he's saying, what you got, what we have as believers. Your love to see fellow humans saved. Your love to see people go to heaven and not go to hell will override cowardice. It don't mean you might not have a little something going on, but you're going to overcome it, right? Because courage is in the face of. He said, you know what? They need to know Jesus. I ain't never been there. I'll read every book I can about them, but I'm going. Because I don't want them to go to hell. Love is a powerful agent to overcome fear. Oh, take a little cat, and you go, you stomp at it, it'll run from you, unless it got babies. If it got babies, that cat will fight a grizzly bear. I ain't going nowhere, because I love this right here. And the Bible is saying love is so powerful that fear cannot reside. So when the love of God is in us, the fear that's trying to be a barrier to keep us apart tears it down. Last one, number five. Love tears the barriers of falsehoods, of lies. All the lies we believe about other people groups. All the falsehoods. Love tears all of that down. Scripture says this. He will, talking about Satan, he will use every kind of evil deception to fool those who are on their way to destruction. Because they refuse, somebody say refuse, to love and accept the truth that would save them. So God will cause them to be greatly deceived and they will believe these lies. The love in us. He put in us power, love, and a sound mind. Causes us to seek after truth. What is the truth and what does God's word say about it? I'm not going to just complicitly believe a lie. You said that we are one people. I'm a lover of truth. You say there's one God, one faith, one Lord, one baptism. You say that we were made one in your body through the cross. Then I'm a lover of truth, which means it tears down every lie. I love all of my brothers and sisters in Christ. Those I see before me, those that are viewing this, those across the world, I don't care what ethnic group they belong to. I love them. And my love will tear down every barrier that will try to keep us apart. Here's what you got to walk out. Here's the last. Love is an easy talk, but a challenging walk. Now, this all sounded good, but you're going to have to walk this out with people who don't look like you, think like you, people who worship with loud music, people who worship with no music, people who praise loud, people who praise inwardly, whatever. So that's the challenge. How do we walk it out? Last thing is this. Love on the cross creates the bridge to allow us to come together and be united. Somebody say amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.